Museum Roadshow on BCTV is supported in part by the Reading Public Museum.
Hello, and welcome to this edition of the Museum Roadshow. I'm Fred Opalinski, your host, and with me is Colin Gallen, who is in the Education Department here at the Reading Public Museum. And although it's springtime in Berks, we are about to take you back to the Ice Age with an absolutely wonderful, child-exciting display of animals from post-dinosaur era, and I can't wait to show the audience what we've got here. You hear some of it in the background, I'm sure. Colin, why don't you introduce us to the show?
Well, this show is a really unique show that kind of similar to the dinosaur exhibit we had last year, where we have large, life-sized animatronic Ice Age creatures. I think we have at least 8-9 different species of animals that we can experience, most of which come from our most recent glacial period. Now, the reason I say glacial period instead of Ice Age is because technically what most people think of an Ice Age isn't what an Ice Age is.
They come and go, is that what you're thinking?
An Ice Age lasts upwards of 10 million years, where you'll have the Earth freeze and thaw and freeze and thaw over and over again. So when people say the Ice Age, they're thinking of the most recent glacial period, so the last time the Earth was frozen. So the majority of these animals, we call it the Ice Age, but in reality, that's not what an Ice Age is, and I'm very excited.
Okay, so tell us more. These animals go back much further?
Yes, yeah. The majority of these animals lived between the past 2 million years, which is our current Ice Age that we're living in right now. But we do have animals that span back even further, as far back as 38 million years when we get to the Diatryma and animals like that. So we really do encapsulate not just the Ice Age, but also all the mammals that have lived since the dinosaurs.
Well, let's have a look, shall we?
Absolutely.
All right, our first stop is with this sort of elephantine-looking creature, but that's not what it is, right?
Not at all. This is a platybelodon. Now, the platybelodon does look a little bit like an elephant, but you'll notice...
And sounds a little bit like an elephant.
Just a tad. But if you take a look at its, what would be its trunk, it actually opens up and it's a giant mouth, and it has these two large teeth at the front, which it would use for scooping up marshy plants. So this guy wasn't a plant eater, he was an herbivore, and he, luckily, I guess for us, because he is terrifying, is extinct. This animal has a lot of unique characteristics that have not survived into today's species, sadly. We don't have any animals that look anything like this today. But he was a very unique animal that did go extinct about 5 million years ago, before our current Ice Age.
And where did he live?
Europe, Africa, and Asia mostly.
Okay, so not North America.
Not here, no.
Okay, all right. Let's move on. All righty. So we've got a family gathering here at home, and would you like to tell us a bit about this group?
Sure. So these guys are most likely our great, I don't know, times a million grandparents. These guys are Australopithecus, which are currently believed to be the oldest ancestor of humanity. Their fully grown adult was about the size of an average six-year-old, so they were rather small in stature, and they kind of look like a mixture between humans and monkeys. Some of the human-like features that you can see are on their feet. They have almost identical feet to humans. Additionally, they would use tools and raise their young, which are traits only found in intelligent mammals.
And these folks lived where?
All over.
Oh, okay.
Primarily, though, in Africa.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, right. Now, the one other thing I like to mention about these guys is that a lot of people believe that they are descendants from today's monkeys, which is just wrong. Humans don't come from today's monkeys. There's ancestors upon ancestors upon
ancestors.
But those ancestors of monkeys weren't really the monkeys we know today. So to say that humans came from monkeys isn't always accurate. Are they related? Most definitely. But did we come from them? No, we came from Australopithecus.
Okay. Well, it's nice to meet them, and they've got a great setting here. And across the way, we have got one giant bird and tiny little horses.
So these are two of my favorite non-Ice Age creatures that we have here at the museum. We've got Heracotherium and Diatryma, the Diatryma being that large, terrifying bird. Now, these creatures both went extinct approximately 38 million years ago, which once again was not during an Ice Age, but the Heracotherium are the ancestor, or believed to be the ancestors, of today's horses. They look a lot like miniature horses, and one of the main reasons why they were able to survive these harsh climates was because they had, we believe, hyperintelligence. The size of their brain compared to their body is massive, which is one of the reasons why scientists believe horses are so smart today. But the diatryma next to him, his brain was not quite as large compared to the size of his body. But this depiction is also incorrect, which is one of the reasons I love to talk about it. When they first discovered the diatryma in the 1890s, we have believed for over 100 years that this guy was a terrifying carnivore. His name even means terror crane because he was thought to be this ferocious meat-eating predator. But the more we research the diatryma and the more science discovers, we find out he's actually incredibly closely related to today's parrots and parakeets, which are some of the only birds in the world that are herbivores. So there's a very high chance that this guy was not a carnivore, but an herbivore.
So the little guy who is dead at his feet is
most likely inaccurate.
Probably not because he was attacked by the bird.
No, right? For all we know, that bird could be helping him get up top.
Yes. In real Big Bird fashion, right?
Absolutely, yes, absolutely. So, can't you tell his yellow Sesame Street-like character?
All right, we've got more to see.
Absolutely.
This looks like one of the few animals that I recognize by name. Let's see if I'm right. Is this the woolly mammoth?
This absolutely is the woolly mammoth. And one thing I really like about the woolly mammoth is how important they were to humans. Humans have lived during the most recent glacial period, and at that time, we used mammoths for clothing and for food, and they only went extinct 10,000 years ago, which means for 95% of human history, we coexisted with woolly mammoths. So they were such an integral part of humanity.
And I think there's one at the Smithsonian, am I right?
Yeah. Absolutely.
I mean, a stuffed one.
Yes, there's one at the Smithsonian, and they're constantly finding mammoth fossils and skeletons all over the country.
So they were here.
They were absolutely here. Yeah.
And just around the corner, we've got some noisy ones, and maybe the cutest ones in the exhibit. What we learned as a saber-toothed tiger, but these are saber-toothed cats, not related to the tiger.
Correct. These guys are not tigers. As far as we can tell, they don't share much DNA with tigers at all. So we call them saber-toothed cats instead of tigers. Additionally, we don't know whether they were striped or spotted or any of that stuff, so calling them tigers is most likely just wrong.
And the sun just rose. That's nice, so we can get a better view. But the kittens, if that's what they're called, are really adorable.
They are really cute. One other thing I just want to mention, I prefer to call them by their scientific name. Smilodon.
Smilodon, because
they have a big toothy smile.
Big smiles, yes. All right, and across the way is something I have never seen before.
Most people haven't, and in fact, before this exhibit, I had never heard of this creature either. So this is a Beluchatherium. The Beluchatherium we believe to be the largest mammal to have ever existed. It was about twice the size of a woolly mammoth and four times the weight of modern elephants.
Four times the weight of an elephant.
Yes, so he
look substantial.
He was a massive creature. He was a plant eater, and he lived in Asia.
And he ate a lot, I would bet.
He definitely did. Although, unfortunately for the Ice Age, he did not live during the Ice Age, as he went extinct about 25 million years ago.
All right, well, Colin, we're going to have to contend with some noisy creatures, among them this gigantic sloth, huh?
Yes, so this is the Megatherium, or the giant ground sloth. It's currently being attacked by a Smilodon, or a saber-toothed cat. So the Megatherium are the ancestors to today's sloths. They were these massive creatures that could get to about 20 feet long, and using their tail, they could actually sit upright and reach the leaves on the tops of trees. Now, they were not nearly as slow as today's sloths. They were much more aggressive and had incredibly strong arms, kind of like a bear. They would use those arms to actually pull the trees to them. That is how strong these creatures were. Now, today, looking at today's sloths, you'd never guess it, but they were very terrifying creatures at the time, but were the preferred meal of the Smilodon because they were rather slow.
It's amazing what they're able to determine from studying the fossils and so on.
The fossils are effectively rocks. Yeah. So scientists who can study rocks tell us
to figure
everything
out aggressiveness from the rocks is amazing. Right across from these folks, we've got what looks like a furry rhinoceros.
Yes, so this is a Coelodonta. Coelodonta is the scientific name for the woolly rhino. Now, the woolly rhino, we actually did not always know that it was woolly. For a long time, scientists had believed that it did not have this woolly coat or the fur, or at least not as much as it did. It wasn't until they discovered cave paintings in France which depicted humans hunting woolly rhinos, and they were rather woolly in those photos, in those pictures, which is one of the main reasons why we know just how woolly this rhino was. It mostly lived in Europe and Asia.
Yeah. It's fascinating looking. It looks like a Dr. Seuss character almost.
Most of these do. You never believe they were real until you come here to see them for yourself.
Yeah, so be sure to put this on your agenda. All right, we've got one more, I think, very ominous looking creature.
Yes. Oh my goodness. See if I can't get, this is the hardest pronunciation of any of the names. This is the Didycerus or Didycurus. I'm not quite sure whether it's a hard or a soft C. Okay. But all I know is that this guy is the ancestor to today's armadillos.
Oh.
This is a giant armadillo living in South and Central America. It could get to 13 feet long, and it had a large mace at the end of its tail, which it would flail for protection.
That means business, I could tell. Yes.
Yeah, these were not, these were herbivores, but you didn't want to mess with them. Their shells made up 20% of their weight. That's how thick their shells were.
So they are very tank-like, huh?
Very tank-like, very defensive, and it was very difficult for humans to hunt these.
Well, Colin, thank you for the tour of these Ice Age creatures. This is, by the way, sponsored by the Friends of the Reading Public Museum and Bruce and Renee and the Dietrich Endowment Funds, right?
Thank you.
And it will run until May 6th, so you've got plenty of time to get over here. And I suspect if you're bringing children, they're going to want to come more than once, right?
Most definitely.
All right, thank you again.
Thank you.
All right. Colin, we have gone from the Ice Age, now we're here in the age of modern medicine.
It's fair, something
with Doc McStuffins. And I've got to say, I had not heard of her until the museum exhibit. I don't have any six-year-olds around. I was here on a Saturday, and this place was filled with kids, and will be very shortly as well today. So
yes.
Give us a quick review of what this is about.
So Doc McStuffins is a favorite children's television character, and she is a doctor who fixes toys. But they use the platform not just to talk about toys, but to talk about health concerns, why going to the doctor is a good thing, why washing your hands is important, things like that. So this exhibit helps to illustrate a lot of those points with its own hand-washing station, and you get to dress up and be a doctor, and you can fix your own toys. And
it's, so it's a very hands-on, interactive
exactly.
kind of an exhibit. And we've got emergency room and operating room and examination room, right?
Reception, yes.
So that a child can become aware of all of those things which they may be facing someday, correct?
Exactly, yeah. Because a six-year-old may think you go to the hospital and everything's one big place, but there's all these different components to a hospital or to a veterinary institute or anything that might be relevant to the medical industry that they can actually get an introduction level here while at the same time keeping it all fun, all friendly, and with games and activities to keep children entertained without realizing they're learning.
And with the real focus being on their own health and well-being.
Of course.
Correct. Yes, yes. So another great place to bring kids.
Yeah. Absolutely. Our weekends are very busy, and we'd love to see them even get more so. So
yes.
Please.
Be sure to come in. Now, this exhibit is sponsored by the Wells Fargo Center and the Berks County Community Foundation.
Yes.
And it will be here until May 20th.
Yes.
So another great opportunity to bring a family.
There's so much new stuff to see at the museum, and we highly, especially for kids this time of year. So we highly recommend bringing them in before May.
I am now here with Scott Schweigert, who's the curator at the Reading Public Museum, and we've gone from a riot of noise with the Ice Age animals to a riot of color in this fantastic Keith Haring Symbolic Gestures exhibit.
That's a great segue.
you walk into the room and it's just almost overwhelming. It is so beautiful. Well, why don't you introduce us to the world of Keith Haring, which is our world in many ways. I mean, he's from the area.
That's right.
Right.
Yeah. He was born right across the street in the Reading Hospital and was born in 1958. And of course, is a hometown hero to many because he became an international sort of superstar in the world of art. But he had humble beginnings and he was raised in Kutztown. Went to Pittsburgh to art school. Commercial art was what he studied first. And he had his first solo exhibit in 1978. And actually, that's what this show is kind of commemorating. This is the 40
years ago.
40 yeah. years ago was his first solo exhibit, which was an exhibit that actually was sort of by mistake. someone had dropped out in their exhibition schedule, and they gave Keith a show as a young man. But then shortly after that, then he moved to New York City and came into contact with all sorts
Andy
of
Andy Warhol and
right
and
companies, yeah. Exactly. Yeah. And you know, was eventually discovered, got gallery representation, but of course started sort of on the subversive side of things with his subway,
subway art, spray painting.
He was always looking over his shoulder. But the show is about 36 pieces, lots of private local collectors and some family members who have been extraordinarily generous in keeping a presence of Keith here at the museum over the last more than decade or so. Of course, we did a major retrospective back in 2006 of Keith's work, where almost the whole top floor was dedicated to his work. But we thought it was time, about 12 years out from that show, time to revisit Keith in an exhibit that features paintings, sculptures, prints, of course, and a couple photographs, and uniquely some early works from
his high school age.
High school works from the 70s.
Am I right that his first public exhibit was here at the Reading Museum a couple of years before the Pittsburgh show?
There was a
contest,
there was a bicentennial, a contest to mark the bicentennial, and I think he submitted a map of Berks County with all sorts of notable places marked on it. And so that, I believe, was part of that bicentennial exhibit that we did here at the museum. So yes, that is true. So he would have been, he would have been probably a junior or senior in high school at that time.
And so this is a couple of high school pieces, huh, where you see maybe the beginning of what we've come
right,
to
yeah,
understand.
You see the bold outlines, you see the bright colors. Of course, the materials that he's using here are a slightly different kind of magic marker or watercolor, but he does use those big, bold outlines that we come sort of to associate with him. Obviously, a very, very keen sense of graphic quality to his
layout and design.
Layout and design, and I these are sort of psychedelic, I think they're sort of Sergeant Pepper and Yellow Submarine. You can see those influences here, sort of album covers, popular culture, rock.
He was very much into
Grateful Dead at this particular moment. So it makes sense that this art would reflect sort of at this moment in his career. But the show then shows works from the 1980s, really when he began to make a very big name for himself, everything from screen prints to wood blocks to ink on plexi.
Lots of different mediums.
And he was always experimenting. I mean, that was the thing with Keith, is that he loved experimenting with new materials. The big yellow painting on the back wall is a vinyl tarp that you could pick up at the local hardware store.
It looks to me like a chalice, but that's my church background coming
right. It could be a chalice with figures coming out of it, or it could also be someone's head. You see those X's that he uses could be eyes.
Yes.
So a bust, with a head sort of, the top coming off of the head with those expressive figures jumping out. So, but Keith sort of had his own language, and that's essentially what the show deals with, is his symbols that he, these recurrent symbols, the dog, the radiant baby, the angel, the three-eyed face, the X's, right? All of these things, they were sort of hieroglyphics for him that he repeated in this kind of almost tantric way throughout the course of his career. Of course, he was inspired by the pop artist, but he was also inspired by the world around him. Graffiti artist influenced him, teenage graffiti artist like Angel Ortiz, who was just a kid when Keith met him, but the two of them collaborated. He also collaborated very famously with Andy Warhol as well. So.
And some of Keith's outdoor artwork is being restored, right? After all of these years, the weather's taken its toll.
Right. A lot of those outdoor murals in places. Actually, I had a museum donor say she was in Pisa a couple of years ago and got on a bus at the bus station and looked up, and there was a giant Keith Haring mural above her in Italy.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
Right, he spent a lot of time in France, in Italy, in Switzerland, in Germany, doing projects. Actually, the big red dog here in the center of the room is based on a project that he did in Münster in Germany in the 1980s. And so, yeah, he was a jet setter in many ways. He opened up a pop shop, not just in Soho, but also in Tokyo, where he sold a lot of his sort of branded materials. Now, the pop shop in both places has closed, but you can still go online and buy material on the online pop shop.
Shirts and things like that.
So, yeah. Right, the, you know, buttons and shirts and, branded materials. And that's, we have three examples from the pop shop print series as well here. So that aspect of his career. So, because Keith was really dedicated to the idea of art for everybody, that you didn't have to go into the museum and see that it would be all around you, including on the streets, on buildings, and at the store. And so he sort of embraced this idea of getting his material out there. The Radiant Baby was sort of his signature, and he handed out little buttons to people on the subway who sort of complimented his work. So these buttons became coveted by folks who would ride the subways and catch him in the
we've
process.
We've got the Radiant Baby back here on the left side of the wall. Right. And we've got a couple. Are these folio sets or?
They are. These are series. He did six different pop shots, and these are three from that series.
We've got the chocolate Buddha here, and then this set from the pop shop. If you could just. Because these are the most vibrant. I mean, the colors are just
right. Vibrant. So these have sort of the fluorescent, brilliant colors that we associate often with the 80s and the MTV generation. Keith is using, again, graphic, bold lines. You see all those motion lines that we see, and he got those from the world of comic books. His dad was sort of an amateur comic artist, and the two of them, when Keith was a child, sort of used to play this game of doodling on pieces of paper, and so it was. So it was sort of
his talent was nurtured at home.
It was indeed. But
now,
yeah,
these are not titled. Am I right?
Right. This is just the Pop Shop series. Yeah. This happens to be the number two.
You could read into what maybe is intended here.
Right.
Perhaps,
so there's always lots of activity. So this figure sort of literally walking on water. This one doing a back bend. This figure sort of being pulled in two different directions. And this one. A figure who's got bodies but no head.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is the computer age stuff.
Exactly. So yeah, we've got a figure sort of being pulled out of the computer. I mean, Keith was always of his own time, of course, thinking about changes. And by the mid 80s, of course, it's sort of the dawn of the personal computer when companies like Apple and IBM and Microsoft were really at their very beginnings. And so the famous "See no evil, hear no evil."
Evil, yes.
Yeah, speak no evil. So again, recognizable symbols from our own world, from our own time, was something that Keith was all about for sure. And then over here we see the dog, the Radiant Baby, and the angel appearing in this pop shop. This is pop shot number four, but these came sort of at the end of his career in the late 80s and the early 90s. Of course, his career really only lasted about a little bit more than a decade. Unfortunately, you know, he would have been, he would turn 60 this year. So it's amazing to think about what he wasn't able to accomplish.
These things became so iconographic, really, in the art world and pop world, and he was able to accomplish so much.
But we're so proud of him here, and we're grateful, again, to the very generous loaners to make a show like this happen. This show is up through tax day, so April 15th.
So not a whole lot of time.
Right.
And it is sponsored by EthoSource.
It is right here in Reading. There's even a little Amish couple over here that Keith did, which is a homage to his roots here.
The hex sign.
The hex sign, yes. And the male and the figure.
The Kutztown Folk Art Festival.
Exactly. exactly. Yeah. So he never forget where he came from, which is really wonderful.
Well, thanks so much. This is just the taste of it, and we again until tax day.
Right.
Get away from the taxes. Come here for a break.
Sign that form. Go to the post office and come by and see the show before it closes.
Yeah, great, great. We've got something else we're going to see.
Right, Fortuny etching the exotic downstairs.
Spanish artist. Right?
That's right, Fred.
Let's go downstairs and take a look at works in paper.
All right, terrific.
All right, we're down here in the lower level of the museum in the Works on Paper Gallery for a collection that the museum owns, right?
That's right. These are all drawn from our collection.
And Mario Fortuny, a 19th century artist who did paintings and etchings, but we're focusing on the etchings and engravings both?
That's right. So he did etchings, watercolors, and oils, and we have each of those in the show. It's called Etching the Exotic because he spent time in North Africa.
Morocco,
and was influenced by all of the architecture and the Arab scenes that he saw there. He's actually the subject right now of a big show at the Prado in Madrid, where his paintings, so he's been given a massive retrospective. But here at the museum, we have more than 20 etchings by the artist, so we wanted to do a show that commemorated his contribution. He, like Keith Haring, actually only lived until his 30s. He lived for most of his career in Rome, spent some time in Paris, but was born in Spain, went to school in Barcelona, and then went on to do great things, and was eventually represented by Goupil, one of the leading art dealers in Paris at the time.
And how did the museum happen to get such a large...
They were all purchases in the teens and the 20s, so in the very early days, he was very popular with American audiences. So I'm guessing my suspicion is that someone well connected to the museum was a fan of Fortuny, and that's how we ended up with so many.
We've got this
exactly.
Great
but let's go explore some of his works.
All right, we're here in the Works on Paper Gallery, and Scott, I'm just going to ask you to take us through. We begin with a is it a self-portrait?
It's not a self-portrait, actually. It's by a fellow artist, an American artist named Ferris, who was very influenced by Fortuny. And so this is a portrait of the artist, of the Spanish artist, again, who only made it into his 30s. And we also remarkably have this cast of his actual hand.
The hand that accomplished all of this.
The hand that accomplished all of this. Yeah. He was extraordinarily prolific, even though he was only working into his mid-30s. He died of malaria, by the way, in Italy, so his career was cut short. But many of the themes and the subjects really resonated with his audiences. So the Orientalist subjects from North Africa, the sort of courtly scenes set in the 18th century became very popular. Courtesans and gentlemen of the court certainly were subjects that were wildly popular. He was often imitated, and so his reputation got watered down a bit in the early 20th century, but there's a new reassessment of his work, and he is an extraordinary draftsman. He sort of took watercolor from a preparatory process to something that could be polished and finished.
Stand on its own,
exactly. And in the world of etching, he sort of stood shoulder to shoulder with Rembrandt and Goya, according to contemporary critics.
Etching is not something that is accomplished quickly.
No, it isn't.
And so to be so prolific in such a few years is really...
It is really extraordinary.
To his gifts.
Exactly. And etching is often the way to establish a reputation very broadly, and I think that's certainly helped his career.
Because you can make so many copies of it.
Exactly. And he lived a very cosmopolitan life. I mean, you know, he grew up in Catalonia, and then he went on. He lived in Granada for a while. He was in Morocco for almost 2 years. He spent most of his career in Rome, and then he was in Paris, too. So, you know, he was sort of a jet setter in a way.
Well, show us some of the things that you think maybe are the most significant.
Okay, sure. I mean, the painting here that belongs to us is a Roman scene. It's called The Note. It's a little genre subject, so a little messenger boy has just delivered a note to this really elegantly dressed woman sort of on a terrace. You see it sort of in the afternoon or the late day sun reflecting on those beautiful Roman structures. Anyone who's been to Rome knows that light for sure.
And even here,
you see the contrast of light and darkness.
Exactly.
That's evident in the etchings, but he's also...
Yeah, he's a master of light. He's a real master of light. But he has a very sort of delicate touch. He's a precise artist, but also can be sort of fluid with his strokes. And that, of course, is the case, especially with something like The Botanist here. If you look very closely, I mean,
the detail
is extraordinary. But then he's sort of got this caricature-like figure. So he creates these almost narrative...
Tells a story.
I was going to say, he creates these almost narrative scenes out of a portrait. The mandolin player, of course, you get that wonderful effect of sort of the satin of her dress, which is really hard to achieve. Mm-hmm. Anyone who does watercolor knows how tough something like that.
This
is a watercolor. So we're very lucky here at the museum to show at least three different dimensions of his work, watercolor, etching, and oil, which is really remarkable. And then we sort of shift into some religious subjects with a hermit, a church scene, two cardinals over here, and then we begin to explore the North African subjects, the Arab scenes. And then at the end of the show, we sort of bring in a contemporary Orientalist who really speak to the idea of the exotic and what that meant in the late 19th century. So he's born in 1838, and by 1874, he's already dead, which is really extraordinary. So, you know, sort of a hot light that shone very brightly for a very short period of time. But I think his reputation, again, this reassessment that's going around right now, it's great for us to be a part of that.
Well, as you know, this is a part of the museum's permanent collection. The exhibit runs until...
The end of May, so May 27th. So it's up for a bit longer than the Haring show is. But we're happy to have it on view. And again, these are from the collection. So these ordinarily would be living in drawers quietly and works on paper.
It's so wonderful to have them out.
Right.
And they're the kind of thing that you really do want to spend time with. So I encourage folks to come and... linger at each and see the genius that's evident in each of these pieces.
Absolutely. We encourage close looking in this gallery. It's intimate in scale, and so it encourages that sort of relationship between you and the
work. It's a nice quiet space. The rest of the museum is very lively.
I always call this the orphaned gallery because it doesn't unfold the way the others do in the floor plan.
It's a place to contemplate and to appreciate.
Absolutely. So seek it out. Mariano Fortuny, not a household name, but once you see his work, you'll understand why he was so powerful in his own time.
Yeah, thank you so much, Scott.
Pleasure.
Well, I do want to mention an upcoming event. We've got Dogs and Brews Memorial Day weekend, May the 27th from 12 to 4. It is a fantastic time for folks to bring their dogs,
Fido,
I guess we're not welcoming cats, they're Fido friends, and to the tent outside near the Arboretum to enjoy beer and local food, craft beer.
Right,
and
lots of vendors, yes.
And the dogs can enjoy each other.
That's right.
Again, that is Memorial Day weekend, Sunday, May 27th from 12 to 4. A great fun time for the museum.
I think this is maybe the fifth year or the sixth, I can't remember. It's either fourth, fifth, or sixth.
Yeah.
But it's been a popular event here at the museum.
Yeah, good. We'll hope for good weather
this weekend. Yes, indeed.
Yeah. Thank you, Scott.
Sure,
and
pleasure.
Thank you for joining us. The Reading Public Museum is this jewel of a place right in your neighborhood, and we certainly do encourage you to come. Bring the children for the exhibits that we talked about. Just bring yourself to enjoy the fine art and the beautiful grounds. Spring is just around the corner, and the Arboretum will be blossoming,
sure,
and a great time to spend there as well. Thanks again for joining us.
Museum Roadshow on BCTV is supported in part by the Reading Public Museum.